Let's do one more, very similar context, but slightly different, subtly different. So here we are saying C1 has the same formula, equals A1 plus B1. But now we are saying we are going to copy and paste it into D2, not D1. So now what formula gets pasted? Once again, pause the video. Once you have an answer, continue and check your answer. Okay. So clearly what's going to get pasted is equals B2 plus C2. That is because we are saying that the formula effectively says add up the cell, two cells to the left, same row, to one cell to the left, same row. In the context of D1, two cells to the left, same row is B2. One cell to the left, same row is C2. And therefore, what's going to get pasted is equals B2 plus C2. Okay, let's beat the same context one more time. So once again, C1 has the same formula, equals A1 plus B1. But now we are saying if you copy that and paste it into F3, what's going to get pasted? Okay, so we're now going to copy it from here and paste it into F3. And we are talking about what formula is going to get pasted into F3. Once again, pause the video, determine a solution, and then continue. Right? Again, we are interested in what formula gets pasted, not the result that's going to be displayed, just what formula is going to get pasted. So pause the video. Once you have an answer, continue. Okay, so once again, it's the same logic. Right, it's two cells to the left, same row, one cell to the left, same row, and what you're going to get is D3 equals D3, because that is what is two cells to the left, same row. One cell to the left, same row is E3, so it's going to paste equals D3 plus E3. But of course, D3 and E3 are both empty, and therefore F3 will actually show the result of 0. As I have said already, this is one of the important concepts in Excel, and therefore it's worth getting a lot of practice to ensure that you really understand what's going on. So here goes one more. Okay, so now let's say this cell C2 has the formula equals A2 plus B2. So once again, two cells to the left plus one cell to the left, same row. Now if you paste it into D4, what formula will get pasted? So pause the video and continue when you have an answer. Clearly, what's going to get pasted is equals B4 plus C4, right? So that's because you're pasting it into D4. Two cells to the left is B4. One cell to the left is C4. That's what is going to get pasted. Not very difficult, just more practice along the same lines. Okay, consider the following situation. So now we've got a cell A6. It has the formula equals sum A2 colon A5. A2 colon A5 is in A6. If you copy the cell and paste it into cell B5, not in B6, but into B5, what formula will be pasted? So pause the video and continue when you have an answer. Okay, so clearly, once again, what you're seeing is that you've got relative addresses. So what this is saying is add up the cells, four cells above, same column, four rows above, same column, and the range begins there and ends at one row above, same column, which is A2 colon A5. But when you put it into B5, that is going to get translated into sum B1 colon B4. Right? So when you're copying and pasting relative addresses, what's going to happen is the formula is going to be retained as is, except that the addresses, the relative addresses in the formula will get replaced appropriately. Okay, so that's really what's going on. I hope you got this correct. Incidentally, I am cooking up fairly arbitrary and artificial situations just for you to get practice. Usually, when you copy from A6, you're most likely to paste it into B6, not into B5. Okay, because most of our spreadsheets are all very symmetric, and most of the time that's what we'll be doing. But just to make sure that you understand the concept, I'm creating all sorts of contorted situations. The next example that you're going to try and solve is no different. It's also a highly contorted situation. But if you get that correct, that means you really understand the concept. Okay, so B5 has the formula equals B4 minus A2. quite unlikely that you will have such a formula, but then just for practice. So B5 is equals B4 minus A2. And if you copy and paste it into D4, what formula is going to be pasted? Okay, so if you can answer this correctly, that means you really understand what is going on with relative addresses. Okay, so pause the video. Once you have an answer, continue. Okay, so with respect to B2, with respect to B5, what is B4? B4 is simply the cell right, one row above, same column. Okay, with respect to B5, B4 is just one row above, same column. Therefore, with respect to D4, one row above, same column is going to be D3. Okay, so that's the first part. So B4 will get translated into D3. And what is B2? What is A2 with respect to B5? It's 1, 2, 3. Three rows above, one column to the left. Okay, so three rows above, one column to the left. So if you are in D4, three rows above is here, one column to the left is here. So that's going to be C1, right? So what is going to obviously get pasted is equals D3 minus C1. D3 is the one cell right above it. C1 is the cell three rows above, one column to the left. Okay, again, this is a highly contrived kind of scenario. You will probably never have to write such a formula, but I just want to make sure that you understand relative addressing. If you got this correct, I can say with a great deal of confidence that you understand relative addressing. Okay, let's do one more example, which is a little more realistic in the sense that it's got more data and it is something that you might actually do. It's somewhat complex, so pay a lot of attention to it. So here we are saying we've got the closing stock prices of a particular stock. This is actually real data. So I've got the closing stock prices of a particular stock starting from 3rd January 06. And in fact, I've got it, I think, for the entire year, 06. Okay, so you can see 3, 4, 5, 6. And then there is no, the stock exchange is closed for the weekend, 7, 8. And again, it starts 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. 14, 15, 16 are closed, whatever, right? So that's the data we have. So we've got the closing stock prices for all the days of 06 in which the stock market operated. And we are showing only, of course, a small subset of the data. So what we want to do is to compute the average percent daily change in price. Okay, that's a somewhat complicated computation. What we mean by that is, so first of all, you already understand what is the percentage change. That is, from January 3rd to January 4th, what was the percentage change in stock price? That we'll put in here. And then from January 2nd to 3rd, we'll put that in here. From 3rd to 4th, that is the percentage change between January 3 and January 4, we'll put that here. And if you keep on doing that, you're going to have a value for every row other than, of course, the very first row, because the price for the previous day is not given to us, which is, you know, the last day of the previous year. That price is not given to us. So therefore, if you're looking at percentage daily change in price, you're going to have values in all the cells, all the rows, except this row 2. Starting from row 3, all the way up to how much ever data we have, we are going to have a percentage change value. Once again, just to jog your memory about how to calculate percentage change, percentage change, of course, is the change divided by the initial value, right? Therefore, if you look at the percentage change between 3rd January and 4th January, it's going to be 3rd January, the change, which is 4th January price minus 3rd January price, 1273 minus 1268, divided by the initial value, which is 1268. Okay, so that's the percentage change between these two days. Okay, now when we say percentage change, of course, if I just do this, it's not going to be a percentage, it's going to be just a fraction. Okay, if it's a percentage, you want to multiply it by 100, but in Excel you can format it as percentage. I show that in a later video. Right now, don't worry about it. We just want to understand the concept. You'll format it as a percentage. Therefore, even though internally it is stored as a fraction, externally it will display as a percentage. That's a that's a complication we don't want to get into right now. Okay, so this is what we want to do in this particular example. So we want to compute the percentage change between 2 and 3, 3 and 4, etc. for the whole year. And then we want to find the average of all of those percentage changes. Okay, so based on all that I've talked about, think of what formula you're going to put in C3. So what is the formula you're going to put in C3 to reflect the percentage change of the stock price between 3rd January and 4th January? So once you put a formula for C3, you can then copy that formula for the entire year. So really, even though we are talking in terms of, 300 values probably, you don't have to write 300 formulas. You're going to write exactly one formula, and you're going to simply copy it for all the remaining cells. Okay, so all you need to think about is how do I correctly write that one formula. Okay, so right now, pause the video, find out what formula you're going to write for C3, commit to an answer, and then continue the video to see if you did it right. Okay, let's continue. Okay, so what we want to do obviously here is we want to say equals B3 minus B2, which is B3 minus B2, that is the change in price, and you divide the change by B2, which is the initial value. That's exactly the formula that I had described just a minute ago, right? So we simply reflect that formula. Of course, parentheses are very important because you want to compute the difference and divide the whole difference by B2, which is the initial value. So once you do that, you'll actually get a fraction here. But what I've done is in Excel, I have formatted it as a percentage, right? To format it as a percentage, all you have to do is, if you're in the Home tab, you can go and find, you'll see a percentage sign in the toolbar. And you click on that, it'll display it as a percentage. I'm not getting into that right now. If your screen is simply displaying 0.0037, that's fine. Let it be. Okay, so this is how you're going to do this. Now, in order to apply this formula for the rest of the days of the year, you're not seeing all the days. You're seeing only 19 rows, but there are more than 300 rows in this spreadsheet. So if you want to copy this formula for the remaining days of the year, what you could do is you could do it in several ways. You can copy this cell and then paste it, select the entire range from B4 to whatever is the last cell in that thing, select the entire range and then click paste. Or alternately, you can use the fill handle here, click and drag this as far as you want, and it'll keep on copying and pasting the formula, right? So that's what I've done. I've done the fill handle, and it's showing all the percentage changes. Okay, so this is how you're going to put in this value. Okay, now notice incidentally that it is showing the percentage change between January 4th and January 5th as 0.00%. And that'll be true only if the two values are exactly the same. Well, the two values are very close to each other, to 1273.46 and 1273.48. And therefore, when it rounds off the percentage to two decimal places, you're not seeing the difference. So it's probably 0.0002 or whatever it is, some very small value. Okay, that's what you're not seeing here. That's why you're seeing zero. So don't get confused by that. So okay, so if you do this and if you click and drag for the entire range, you'll get the percentage change for all of those years. Okay, so right now, just for illustration, I copied it only for C4 up to C19. Okay, and then in C20, I put in this formula to compute the average. I said equals average C3 colon C19, and you got the average. Okay, so this is what the question was asking for. What is the average percentage change for the data shown here? And we've got this, right? Now, of course, as I told you, the original spreadsheet has data for a whole year. For illustration purposes, I clipped it to show just 19 rows. Okay, that completes our discussion of relative addresses. As I have said, Excel has really only a few complex important ideas. Everything else is just embellishments on top of those few ideas. You have now learned one of the most important ideas within Excel, and that is the idea of relative addressing. Let's now take a look at the types of addresses that Excel has. Relative addresses are not the only kind of address that Excel has. Okay, till now every single address that we have used so far is a relative address. So for example, B2 is a relative address. Okay, now what makes it a relative address is the fact that you simply have the column name and the row number. That's it, there's nothing else. But let's take an example of what another kind of address might be. Okay, now for the moment, don't worry about where you're going to use the other kind of address, what does it mean, how does it work. All of that will be covered in the next video, but I just want to give you a prelude to what you're going to see in the next video. Okay, so the same address, if you want to make it into an absolute address. Okay, an absolute address is an address that Excel simply will not change. It'll copy it as it is. Right, now we already learned that when you have a relative address, Excel is going to change the address when you copy and paste it. With an absolute address, Excel says, this is an absolute address, I'm going to paste it exactly as it is. No matter where you're copying from, where you're pasting to, doesn't matter, it'll remain as it is. Okay, we'll see why it's used and where it's used and all the details in the next video. So that's an example of an absolute address. Okay, now you may say, well, what makes it an absolute address is the presence of these dollar signs. Okay, $B, $2. We've put a dollar before the column name and we've put a dollar before the row number. And then there are other types of addresses as well. There's one other type of address, and you see an example here. You see two examples here. $B2. So in this case, we have the dollar only before the column name and not the row number. And here we've got the column name as it is, but we've got a dollar sign before the row number. Again, we'll see later on how these addresses work, where they're used and so on. These are called mixed addresses. Okay, so in Excel, you've got three types of addresses. Relative address, which you are now masters of. Absolute address, which we'll be talking about in the next video. And mixed addresses, which also we'll be talking about in a later video. Okay, so these are the three types of addresses that Excel has. Let me give you a quick preview of the copy-paste behavior of the three types of addresses. Okay, so relative address, we know that in this case, the row and the column are relative, and therefore both of them get changed when such an address is copied and pasted. Right, we know that row and column are both relative because there's no dollar sign at all. Okay, when you have this absolute address, $B, $2, the presence of the dollar sign indicates that both column and row are absolute. Okay, because if you put a dollar before something, it makes that element absolute. We put a dollar before the row and the column, the column name and the row number, it makes both of them absolute. So Excel is going to say, I'm not going to change the address at all. In a mixed address, the part following the dollar is absolute and remains unchanged, and the other part is relative and gets changed. So in this case, if your address was $B2, then the column will still remain as $B. But the 2 is relative because there is no dollar preceding it, and therefore the 2 will change appropriately. Similarly here, it says $B2, so B is relative because it's not preceded by a dollar, and therefore the column name is going to change, the row number will remain unchanged. Okay, now don't worry about it if it's not clear to you right now how all of these things work or where they may be used. We're going to look at all of that in detail. I just gave you a small preview of what we're going to see.